I'm Paula Conway. I'm the president of Astonish Media Group. We are a boutique media agency specializing in public relations, branding, and marketing in Manhattan. We represent celebrities, film stars, TV stars, major corporations, and all the way to early stage startups. And I'm going to talk to you, give you some tips on getting a great job. But first, I'm going to ask a question. Where does money come from? Does anybody know? There's no wrong answer. Just where do you think it comes from? Where does it come from? We all want it. What?
Hard work.
It comes from the U.S. Mint.
True. Okay, so there's the right answer, or my answer rather, is two words. Remember this for the rest of your life. It comes from other people. And this is very, very important because they have the power. And other people are the ones that decide who they're going to pay and why. So when you think about it, it's a very profound thought. Most of my colleagues have experience, they have talent, they have writing skills, and these are considered hard skills, interview skills, writing a resume, for example. And by the time you graduate from Pace, you will probably have those skills. But what very few people ever talk about are the soft skills. And those skills are simply not taught in a traditional business curriculum. The fact of the matter is, people want to hire people they like and whom they think like them. And your job is to make them believe that. Your job is actually to market yourself. My whole background is in entertainment, public relations, communications, and journalism. And I am here to tell you that you are in sales. Most people are, and definitely at some point in their lives, but as marketing communication students, you absolutely, positively are in sales. So there are four points that we really want to focus on today. One, who has the money? We've discussed that. Other people, right? Thinking, we're going to get to that first. Communicate, hard work. So let's talk about thinking. What do you think I mean by thinking? Okay. What you're doing, why you're doing it, and what the desired outcome is. It sounds so simple because we think all day, every day, but you would be surprised how many people don't think. And we have interns, we have four interns a semester, and we teach them how to think. So for example, we had an intern that came into our company, and her task was to follow up on an email list of about 1,000 plus companies that we had sent chocolate to for a client of ours, for a charity chocolate program. We explained the task. We told her to call and see if they received the information, ask if they had any follow-up questions, and if they wanted to receive the chocolate. That did not happen. What happened was she went through the list dutifully. She finished it. She completed it. Either they received it or they hadn't. Now, you would think that since we told her what to do, that that would have happened. But in fact, it often goes down that way, that we will have somebody working with us for the first time, and they heard it, the sound of what we were saying, but they didn't really absorb it, and she just wanted to get through the task. And that is exactly what she did. So let's take that and let's talk about your resume, for example. What are you communicating in your resume? What is your goal? What is your desired outcome? It's for someone to hire you. When we get a resume in our office that is just packed with information, we toss it out. Because what that tells me is that that person has no idea how to organize and focus their thoughts. They just put it all in there. And maybe they were misguided in terms of what should go in there. That is true. But it should be very clean. It should be very direct. It should be very to the point. It should stand out So I do want to know if during the summer you were walking dogs and bagging groceries, because that tells me you're a hard worker and you're going to do whatever it takes. And a lot of people will leave things like that off thinking, well, it's so menial, it's so, no, it's not. It sends a very powerful message what you do with your time. So let me tell you what happened in June of this year. I was contacted by a neighbor of ours who's in her 80s, and she said, my granddaughter has read all about your company and she really wants an internship with you. I said, fine, have her call me. She called me up, I took her to lunch, I asked her all about where she goes to school, what she's majoring in, why she chose that major, how she spends her free time, where she lives on campus. She didn't ask me one question. She didn't ask me one question. She didn't look at my website. She didn't have my bio with her. She didn't even take notes on what I had to say. I asked her if she was interested in a summer internship or a fall internship. She goes, oh, no, no, not summer. I have a job. Fall, definitely fall. I said, what are you doing? She said, I'm lifeguarding from 9:30 in the morning till noon. 2.5 hours. I said, what do you do for the rest of the day? She goes, yeah, I'm hanging out. I'm hanging out. You know, I'm hanging out with my family. It's so great. I'm going to catch up with my family. So by noon, she was done. So that goes back to my point of we don't see ourselves. We don't see the impression that we make on other people. And what I got from her, and may not be true, but this is the impression I got, and you only get one, was I do not want to work hard. I'm not going to bust my ass. Definitely not for you. I really didn't think through what I wanted. I didn't think this through. I didn't think through the ultimate goal that I wanted to achieve, which was to get that internship, and I didn't do my homework. And that interview was over before the entree came. She just didn't even know it. So now let's talk about communication. You can have the greatest idea in the history of the world, and if you cannot communicate it effectively, it doesn't matter. And a very good example of this is how many people watch Shark Tank? Everybody, right? It's a great show. And how many times, and by the way, I've done business with everybody on that panel, and they are amazing competitors. But how many times have you seen a company, you know, come up to present, and when they're done, one or many of the sharks will say, you really didn't explain the concept very well. You don't have a plan, you don't know what your financial projections are for next year, and for those reasons, I'm out. That is a perfect example of a soft skill. They failed to do their homework, they failed to communicate what it was that they were trying to get $200,000 for. When you write a cover letter, that is the piece of communication, right, that goes with your resume. If I get a cover letter that is filled with information, goes into the bin. Again, get to the point. Make it concise. Make it precise. If you cannot tell someone in 2 to 3 paragraphs at the most what you want and who you are, they're going to throw it away. There's just too many coming in. And one thing I will say is please never start a letter with, I'm writing to you today too. And if anybody ever told you to do it, don't do it. That's 7 seconds of my time that I just don't have. Particularly in communications, marketing, and public relations, everything's due yesterday. You need to get right to it. You need to tell me who you are, what you've done, what you want. Now, it's not just about the words. It's about your personal appearance. And this is often a difficult challenge for everybody. But the truth is, you're a brand. You're marketing yourself. So before you step out the door, you need to think about what you're wearing, why you've chosen this, your clothing, your makeup. When you're interviewing, you want to make 100% eye contact. You be totally present with that person. You want to take notes, in case we haven't learned that one. And always send a written thank you note. You can send an email. We live in a digital world. That's how it's done, yes. Thank you for meeting with me yesterday. Sit down and write that handwritten note. It's a soft skill that's not taught anymore. And when I get a handwritten note from somebody who wants to work for me, I can tell you that's the person that I'm looking at more closely. Because they took the time to do it. And that says a lot about them. It's also becoming a lost art. So that's another thing. Communication is a two-way street. Take in what someone says, what they're actually saying, not what you think they said. And I'm going to give you another great example. So we had a woman who was interning for us, and about 9:30, 10 o'clock at night or something, I sent her a quick email and I said, call me tomorrow morning around 9:30. I'll be in my car driving into the city. I want to go over a to-do list. Never got the call. 10:15, parked the car, got out my phone, texted her. I said, why didn't you call me at 9? And she said, well, there was nothing on my to-do list that we need to go over. I didn't ask her about her to-do list. My text told her exactly what to do. Call me to go over a to-do list. And I gave her the time. Happens all the time. Take the time to breathe. Look at what you're being asked to do. Look at what that email or text says. And don't interpret into your meaning. And if you don't know what it says, say, I don't know. There's nothing more impressive than someone who just says, I just don't know. Or calls and says, can you please explain this to me? I'm going to give you a great example of communication. Does everybody know who Elizabeth Hasselbeck is? Okay. And you know The View. Women sitting around and then I talk coffee. Yeah, okay. So I guess it was about 10 years ago when Elizabeth was on The View, and I work a lot with ABC Television, and a friend of mine who's a producer there and I were having dinner, and I said, can you just explain to me, Natalie, why was Elizabeth chosen? Why did they choose her? You know, she was on Survivor and she had made an impression in national television because of the way she won Survivor, but she didn't have an entertainment background. She didn't have a journalism background. She didn't have anything. She was just this like really awesome, highly rated contestant on Survivor, and she had a good agent. Clearly necessary in this case. She put her hands on the table and she said, do you know why she was chosen? And I could tell she was really revved up about it. She said it was her communication skills, just like that. And I took a step back and I said, what? Are you kidding? And she goes, no. She said, Elizabeth Hasselbeck didn't do what the other contestants did. She didn't come in and talk all about herself and try to impress the executive producers as if that would happen. She did everything they asked her to do. She just followed instructions. Just followed it like a good soldier. And she asked everybody about themselves, other people. She got to know them. She got to figure out how they think, what motivates them, what makes them tick. And it's a skill. It's not something that happens overnight. I've been working on it for 20 years. But every celebrity and every titan of industry that I have ever met has that skill down. It's all about you. And if you are going to pay me, I need to find out what you're about. It's not here. It's out there. And it's interesting that those very skills that she utilized backfired, which got her fired. So it's kind of an interesting dichotomy. But that's also about what happens, in case that's confusing, when you start making a lot of money and you get really powerful. And Stacy, who has been our vice president here, who was in film for many years and knows every celebrity in the book, will tell you, when people get famous, they change. It's human nature. And it's really quite fascinating to watch. We make our clients famous, and then they're different people altogether. Now I want to share with you something else under communication. It's called cultural competence, and you will likely never hear that again. The very astute, very established businesswoman who taught me about cultural competence, or shared that with me rather, it was an amazing concept. Do you have any idea what it means? Great. Good answer. It is your awareness of your surroundings and your knowledge of what to do in any given situation. It applies to absolutely every aspect of your life. So a very, very simple example is, do you know how to have a business dinner in Sweden, which is very different from a business dinner in Japan? That's a whole other class that I teach. But we're talking today about a corporate cultural competence. So let's say you're applying to an early stage startup that makes skateboards. What do you think that environment's going to be like? It's going to be people who are probably all under 30. You're probably going to walk in and see them skateboarding around because they make skateboards. It's going to be chill. They're going to wear jeans. They're going to be looking for somebody who can fit into that corporate culture. That is very, very different from a job at GE. They're not grooving. They're not. They're not dressing that way. You're going to dress up a little bit more. You're going to change your color scheme. You're going to mute the color scheme. This is what cultural competence is. And when you go to apply to these jobs, you're, of course, because we've discussed this, you're not sending a form letter. You're going to do research on the company. You're going to look at the LinkedIn profiles of the person that you're meeting with and the executives. You're going to look at their social media, how they use language. Tells you everything about someone. GE's the same way. And that's going to help you. And then when you get into that company, your job is to adapt to that culture. So you can have all the hard skills, and you can have all the soft skills, but they don't even matter. They don't matter unless you are willing to work very, very, very hard. And hard work means different things to different people. Everybody in this room has a different idea of like working hard. I mean, this young woman that I met with who worked 2.5 hours a day, she thought she was just working. She was working the summer. You know? She thought she was working hard. In her world, that was working hard. In our world, that didn't even, she's on vacation as far as I'm concerned. Let me tell you about the most impressive intern we've hired. My husband and I live in Connecticut, and there's a bank nearby. And there's a young woman who works at the bank. And she very sheepishly said to my husband one day, do you have internships at your company? And he said, yeah, the next time you come, bring your resume. So she did. I called her in for an interview. She dressed beautifully. She looked me in the eye. I said, Alex, you're working full time. What's your life like? Like, how do you see, you know, what are you doing right now with your life? She said, well, I work full time at Bank of America, and then I go to school at night. She's 24. She said, I made some mistakes earlier, and I'm making up for it. So I'm trying to put myself through college and get my degree, and I have a 2-year-old baby at home. She wanted to work for us. And I said, where are you going to find time to work for us? I'm just curious, like, have you thought this through? And she said, well, I did all this research on your website. I did all this research on your company. And I would imagine in your industry, it's very research focused, which it is. That's our power, knowledge. And I was hoping that maybe you could give me a job where I could, you know, come home, put the baby to bed, and then give you a couple hours, like 3 or 4 nights a week, and work on long-term projects. I knew 2 very important things about this woman. 1, she's going to work hard. She's going to do what it takes. And 2, she knows how to organize her time. Because at 24, to have a full-time job, go to school at night to get your degree, and have a baby, you'd have to know how to organize your time, right? Totally impressed. She has been with us for over a year. We love her. And I have had interns come in from Brown, from Harvard, from Yale, and we've kicked them right out the door. Because no one taught them the soft skills. So here's the deal. It comes down to what I just said. Remember these 4 things. Who has the money? Think it through. Learn to communicate well. And be willing to pay your dues and work very, very hard. And if you do these things in your life, I promise you, you will get a job, you will be successful, and you will sell that concept on Shark Tank. And with that being said, are there any questions? Yes?
Would you like to tell us a little bit about your internships?
About our internships? Our internships run for whatever the semester length is. It varies from university to university, and we're flexible within that. We are very heavy on research. So
An ideal internship, of course, is someone who either is interested in public relations, and we really teach you what it means to be, you know, an excellent publicist. And there's a lot of research that you need to do. You know, there really isn't a program that we have found that teaches the things that you actually find out when you get out in the field. So it's a bit of a learning curve, but it's really cool. And there are all these tools that we subscribe to that we teach you how to use. And you do get to talk to journalists eventually. It definitely depends on your skill level. Pitch and play stories. The other internship that we offer is a writing internship. So we're not a traditional agency. We also create content. American Airlines is a client of ours. The New York Daily News is a client of ours. And we create content for our clients. So if you're really interested in writing and I wrote 5 books, by the way. I wrote for the New York Times and Style Magazine, so I have a journalism background. So if you're interested in that and social media, then there's a whole other niche for you there. And they are paid. It's a stipend of $100 a month. Absolutely. I have a pile of papers over here, one-page reading materials that I suggest for anybody who's going into marketing communications, and lollipops. Who does that, right? Lollipops. Oh, and Stacy has a pad. If you want more information from us on helping you find a job, it's all free. You can give us your email address, and I will send you some materials. And if anybody ever wants to email me, it's very simple. It's Paula@astonishmediagroup.com, the company. And if you think you're going to forget, get a lollipop and just put Paula in front of it, and you're good to go. Yes? So you should send a cover letter and a resume. Tell me why you're interested in it. Obviously, you know now. I think you got a little sense of how we are. I want to know what you've done in your background that lets me know that you can handle tasks quickly and effectively and manage time. And your resume. And that's it. And Stacy and I evaluate. Yes. So that's a really great question. So she doesn't want to go because her time is so limited and the ability to train her is so truncated because she has to do everything, you know, in a very short period of time and she can't get on client calls, for example. There's things she just can't do. She wanted to stay with us because she knows she needs that experience. Interestingly enough, she's pregnant again. And when she goes on pregnancy leave, she'll be full time for a while. So that'll be kind of nice. And your second part of your question was, what was the second part?
Well, what I was going to ask is that, because in speaking to a lot of students who then graduate, they might go into an internship position right after they graduate. And a lot of questions that I get from students that I kept in touch with is, how long do they stay with that internship before, whether it turns into a job or they have to look towards other ways, because then they start seeing how bills start coming in.
Yes. Right, so translating it is about the skills that you pick up. And that comes down to your availability and your enthusiasm to do more work. And there's another intern that we had. I don't remember if she went on to Disney. Yeah, Stacy found her. And she was so eager to do everything that we gave her a lot of responsibility that we wouldn't give somebody else. And that's what shows me you can do it, because you're stepping up and saying, more. I want more. I want more. Can I get on that call? Can I listen to this? Can I pick up the phone and pitch? Which is a lot of trust, right? So that, getting those skills and being able to tell someone, I know how to put a press list together, incision, backwards and forwards. Here are the pitch letters that I wrote, not that I wrote, because we do all the writing. We do not expect interns to come in knowing how to actually write like we do, and for our work.
But if they can and they show they want to, then you have something to show someone. You have a press release. And then if you get placements, then you show the results of that, you're in such a much better position for a full-time job. In our company, unfortunately, we are an experts-only agency. So we set our company up to be only people who were like vice presidents or higher wherever they were before they came to us. This goes to a philosophical belief of mine about PR firms, but I was at Weber Shandwick, which is a big global PR firm. I was also a vice president at Rubenstein Associates, their youngest vice president. All of this before I went out on my own, and I was a Broadway press agent. My background's actually in theater management. So I noticed that a lot of clients will come in and they'll pay these exorbitant fees, and then they will be pushed off, and this is very standard, on a very junior person who really doesn't have those skills yet. So we don't train publicists. What we do is we have our internship program, and then we help you, you know, to find that next job. And Alex is an exception because of her situation and because she just is who she is. You're always an exception if you just are who you are. The world is not set, nothing set in stone. You shape it. She shaped us. Yes. So that's a great question, and thank you. So we are mostly virtual agency. We have an office in Manhattan. We have an office in Westport, Miami, and LA. But again, because everybody in our company is so senior, they can work from home because we're that good. So for interns, it's virtual, which is why I need to know if you can manage your own time. Because if I give you a project, you know, we'll Skype with you. But if I give you a project and you and I are not sitting in the office, I need to know that you can complete it, because we're going to trust you with it, you know, and report back. So the hours really come down to what you think you can give. And I don't know, Stacy, do we have an average weekly?
I wouldn't say so.
No, it could be 5, it could be 10. You know,
if you can get the work done in an hour, you're good to go. If it's going to take you 6 hours, that's on you.
Yeah. Any other questions? No? Okay.
What are some of the typical projects that you have?
I'm just trying to think of one that's really very recent. You know, when we are, television moves really fast. Shows go on and then they get taken off. Keeping up with that is often hard for us because we don't watch TV. We're just, you know, or we're traveling. So it's always really helpful to have someone research the shows, you know, the morning shows, the news shows, the lifestyle shows, the high-tech shows. We have a lot of tech clients. And that requires you to not just do research, but to watch some television. Now, that sounds so funny, but I would rather someone actually watch that show and say, you know, do a little report back that says, okay, Fab Life, which is now on ABC Channel 7 at 2 o'clock, and I just found this out the other day, you know, this is what they cover, these were the products that were on, you know, it's lifestyle, it's women, it's this, and then do the research to find the producers for the show, if they're not producers that we know. So that's a great project for us. Putting together a press kit for a client, it's a little advanced, but it's always helpful when we can say, here's a really good one that we have for this client, can you emulate it? And we'll let them go and see what they come back with. Web skills are great if you have them. Creating press lists is critical for anybody who interns for us, because you have to do it. If you want to be in public relations, your whole life is press lists. And then understanding how to go through them, you have to have a sharp, tight eye and knowing who to take out and why. Researching blogs, there's so many blogs going up. And because Stacy and I are always working so hard and everybody in our office, and we're older, we don't even know all of the blogs, you know, that 20-year-olds are reading. So having someone come in with that knowledge and help us fill that out is always excellent. Yes, the gentleman and then you, behind you. Yes, go ahead.
You mentioned you don't have any tech clients. Is that chance or choice?
Well, it's always a choice. We turn a lot of clients away, which is an interesting point, that we will only work with clients we like And if we sense that we don't take them on. We happen to be very good at technology and health tech in particular. Yes. No.
Would you assign a writing intern something you wouldn't necessarily assign a PR intern to?
Yeah, so the writing internships are really, really focused on writing and social media, you know, because most people do know how to do some level of social media now. And those are always fun. So we had a project that was related to film and television, or film really, and we had an intern, and her whole job was to just create the social media posts for this Hollywood company. And, you know, we worked with her to talk about what they should be and, you know, what the engagement we were looking for was. She did an excellent job. Excellent job. We also have a lifestyle website that we maintain that's syndicated. New York Daily News is one of our clients, so if somebody wants to write stories for that. We had one intern that was really good, really good writer, and I actually allowed her to byline some New York Daily News articles. But that is, I mean, that's not normal. That's very exceptional. But it can happen. Any other questions?
Well, I'd like to thank you very much. Yeah. Did you have another question?
Just one more. Go ahead.
Did you have another one?
Yes.
I'm looking for somebody who works hard. Honestly, that's the key with us. We've worked with very, very powerful people, and we do all the time. And most people don't want to work hard. They just don't, even if they say they do. That's what I want to see. Discipline, hard work.